Hello YouTube. So guess what? I got in the mail, I got a Yamaha YCL-221 student model low E flat bass clarinet. These are ABS plastic bass clarinets. This is apparently a newer model, which is why I had to wait a little while for it. And they retail for about $2,200. I've been very excited to try this because a lot of you have asked me if I could, and so I will, and so here we go. I'm going to unbox it and we'll take a look. This is the instrument case. It is a, I don't know if you can tell, it's kind of a dark green. I actually really kind of dig the color of this. It is an ABS plastic. This is actually one of the nicest student bass clarinet cases I've seen. I don't know how it looks on the inside, but we'll take a look at it. There are two clasps right here, and here we have it. This is the way it comes from the factory. It's all wrapped in plastic. Let me get rid of that. So here we have a two-piece low E-flat bass clarinet, which is fairly unusual these days. Normally you see them just in one piece, but the two pieces makes it a really nice compact case. One thing that I do notice, the plastic here is brushed to make it look like wood. But the other big thing that I think is kind of cool is that the instead of having corks on the bottom joint, let me show you what it is. One thing that is kind of cool about this instrument that I've never seen before is the fact that there is a rubber O-ring right below the tenon cork here. And on the lower joint, there's no cork at all. There's just two O-rings. What's kind of neat about this is, obviously, if you don't have a tenon cork, it will never rip and you'll never need to repair it. But because they're O-rings, probably all you would need to do is remove the one that's broken, or if it falls off, just put a new one on. That's pretty dang cool. Here, this is an adjustable thumb rest, which is pretty awesome. It's plastic, so it feels nice. It's got a thumb screw here. Why would you ever want to adjust a thumb rest? Well, there is a right position for your hand and a wrong position, a whole bunch of wrong positions for your hand. The right position for your hand is where your thumb and your first finger are parallel. If your thumb is too low, then it's gonna actually look like this, and it creates tension right in here. The tension is not very good for you. And if it's too high, it's also gonna create tension. What you want the thumb and the first finger to be exactly parallel to one another so that they close like so. So in this particular case, this thumb rest is too low for me because when I have my hand in that sort of natural position, I'm not touching the right key. I should be touching this. So what I'm gonna do is I'm going to go ahead, get my screwdriver. I'm gonna move this thumb rest up so that my thumb and my first finger are as, actually it doesn't even go high enough for me really, but my thumb and my first finger are as parallel as possible. So I'm gonna put it in the top position like that, and then I'm gonna tighten the screw. That's how you know when you're in the right ballpark for your thumb and your first finger. So cool. As you can see here, the neck is, it's a single piece, like so. It does not tune here, which means it's gonna tune here. And you just unscrew the screw and you lift it up if it's sharp and you push it in if it's flat. I'm gonna give it maybe about a quarter of an inch to start. It has a single register key mechanism here. So what that usually means is that the intonation of the B, C, and C sharp, these notes here, are gonna be a little bit out of tune, but we'll see. I have no idea. The keywork is the most important part of a student bass clarinet. You want the keywork to stay in place. Once it's adjusted, you want it to stay adjusted. If the metal is soft or if the keys are not high quality material, then the keys will quickly go out of adjustment and you will be spending more time at the repair person. How do you know if the keywork is good, right? I mean, if you're not used to trying a lot of instruments, you won't really know. One way you can tell the keywork is you want to find the longest key. In this particular case, it's this guy, and you want to see how much give it has. You know, it's every piece of metal is going to bend somewhat, but you want to feel it, and you want to feel how easily it bends. Another thing that I do is I'll take a look at this key, like up here. Does it have a lot of give to it? It feels like it has some give. If you're going to compare it to my instrument, let's take this key for example. This key, it jiggles because it needs to be adjusted down here where it's attached, but the metal itself doesn't bend that much. It's jiggling, but it's not bending. And that's how you can kind of tell if the keywork itself is going to hold up in the long run. And this doesn't feel terrible. I felt much worse, but it just makes me a little bit nervous, right? Because if this has got this much play in it, that means that this hole right here that it's covering is going to sometimes be covered, sometimes it might not be covered, and you just got to be careful that the pad is always covering it. One thing I really dig about this instrument, and I think is super important to consider, is that these pads have resonators on the bottom of them. I'm going to take a pad off to show you what a resonator looks like. So I took off the low G key from the bottom joint of the instrument so that I could show you what all this is. On the back side of the key, ba ba ba, is the pad. Now this pad is leather, which is great. Leather pads are very durable and if you take care of them. And really, you don't have to do an awful lot to take care of them, so they're gonna last you a good long time. But what I really like is that this brown piece here is called a resonator. And what a resonator is, well, let me put it this way. This pad is sort of cushiony leather, which is important because it needs to seal the hole when the pad is closed. However, because it's cushiony, it absorbs some of the sound energy. What this disc in the middle does, it acts like a reflector, kind of like if you were practicing in a bathroom. You know how much brighter it sounds when you're in a bathroom? That's what these resonators do. And there are resonators on all of the keys up and down the instrument when they're large enough. If they're too small, it won't have one. But most of the keys on this have a resonator. And that is extremely cool because that reflects the sound energy back into the bass clarinet. And it makes the bass clarinet feel more resonant and it has a little bit more of that nice reedy bass clarinet-y sound. I am so pleased that this instrument comes with one of these. So I'll put it back on and play it. Do you hear that? I'm not too keen on that because it feels like, oh, maybe it was sticking a little bit. You wanna make sure this pad is opening when you're hitting the register key. So it seems like this might need a little bit of grease or I might need to loosen it. Again, it's always good to have a repair person go over the instrument before you leave the shop because little things like this will just force you to have to go back. Yeah, all right, so just loosen it a little bit. Yeah, the octave key is gonna give me a little bit of some trouble. Okay, so I'm going to do what I've done before, which is do a blind test that kind of seemed to work pretty well. I'm going to play one piece of music on my black bass clarinet, and I'm going to play the second one on this guy. All right, so I'm going to turn the lights off so you can't see which instrument I'm playing first, and here we go. The second one was this bass clarinet, the Yamaha. The first one was my Selmer bass clarinet, the Model 67, the Privilege. And, you know, what makes this obvious, I think, to me, is that when I go over the break, I am struggling like heck with this register key mechanism. Next thing we're going to do is look at its intonation. Okay. So this is my favorite tuning app, iStroboSoft. And the way it works, as a quick reminder, is we're going to look at this third bar here. This is not the super fine tuning, but the sort of medium fine tuning. The coarse tuning is over here. We're going to pay attention to this guy here. What we want to do is we want to make it stop moving. If it stops moving, that means we're in tune. If it moves north, if it goes up, that means that it's sharp. And if it goes down, it means it's flat. So that was me not looking at the tuner.
really. I mean, I saw it, but I wasn't paying a lot of attention to it because I wanted to see how the instrument was sort of naturally in tune with itself without me making a lot of adjustments with my embouchure, etc. So I'm actually kind of impressed with it. Okay, overall, what do I think? I love the case. The case is super awesome. Actually, I wish they could sell this case so that you could buy it. Maybe they do for other bass clarinets that come apart this way, because it's really actually a pretty terrific, pretty solid case. The instrument itself is pretty in tune, as we just saw. It sounds nice and reedy. The one thing I really cannot abide is the fact that this back register key needs to be adjusted, and I just don't like going over the break because it feels sloppy, right? I push the key and it opens eventually, but I need it to open right away, and so do you. Otherwise, you're going to have issues going over the break. The keywork itself, it feels pretty good. Time will tell. Any of you who have one of these, let us know in the comments so that we can all sort of learn from you. Overall, you know, for the price, it's not a bad low E-flat clarinet. Now, you can get a low C bass clarinet from Kessler and a couple of others for about the same amount of money. So it really matters whether or not you, if you're going to be marching, for example, and you don't need a low C, it's nice not to have to carry around that extra weight, for example. It really depends on what you're doing. But if you're into having a low C, you might want to look at a different instrument, because the Yamaha does not come in a low C model. It only comes in a low E-flat model, which is kind of a shame. Finally, my favorite thing is that it comes with an instruction manual. I have never seen an instrument come with an instruction manual before, and I actually read it because I wanted to see what it was going to teach me. It teaches you how to put the instrument together, tells you how to attach the reed and how tuning works. It talks about what happens after you're done playing and how to swab it. By the way, it comes with a swab and all that stuff. But here's my favorite part, troubleshooting. The tone is not clear. The instrument plays out of tune. Take the instrument to your dealer for a repair. If pads are deformed or air is leaking from the instrument, take your instrument in for repair. The keys are stiff. The keys do not move. If the keys are bent, take the instrument into your dealer for a repair. The joint is too tight or loose. If the joint cork is torn, take your instrument to a dealer for a repair. All right, so there you have it. Troubleshooting. You can't do it yourself. Baloney. I've never seen that before, so I had to share that with you. Okay, so this is the Yamaha YCL-221 bass clarinet. I would say I would give it a thumbs up if that's what you're looking for a low E-flat. This is one of the better low E-flat bass clarinets that I've tried. So hope this was helpful. All of you who wanted a review of this instrument, you're welcome. See you next time.